von daher.
Evening, Gordon. How are you?
What's your sound, Gordon?
Is that better? So I'll start again, Vern. Welcome you all to the Lodge Hope of Karachi, our 18th Zoom meeting. It's a delightful evening outside, so I'm glad that you've come along this evening to join us. As ever, can I remind you all of the Grand Lodge of Scotland guidance for digital meetings. I require you to have your video camera working and a recognisable name within the screen. I would encourage you all to sign the virtual tile on the Lodge Hope of Karachi Facebook pages, and if there's any questions for Brother Frederick at the end of his presentation, please put them into the chat room. Well, this evening, at no great expense, I'm delighted to welcome Brother Frederick Vowth. I hope I've pronounced his surname correctly. Brother Frederick's going to talk to us about the history of French Freemasonry. Brother Frederick was initiated in September 1990, nearly 30 years ago. And he's had the luck to work with several Blue Lodge rituals, as well as French ritual, the ancient accepted Scottish ritual, English emulation. And he created a French-speaking lodge using the standard Scottish ritual. And he has got a desire, Brian, to one day visit a Scottish lodge, albeit he's this evening visiting a virtual Scottish lodge. We hope that one day we'll see him in person, face-to-face. I first came across Frederick as we're both members of the Internet Lodge under the United Grand Lodge of England, and when I heard them give this presentation a couple of months ago during lockdown, I felt that it would tie in very nicely with some of the previous presentations we've had here this evening. So, Brian, without further ado, I'm going to allow Frederick to share his screen and hand over to Brother Frederick Vowth. Frederick.
Hello, Brian. I hope you will see my presentation with the PowerPoint shortly.
Yeah, we can see that, Frederick.
Okay. Yes. Thank you. Okay. So I will try to cover 300 years of French Freemasonry in 30 minutes and in two steps. So let's go. So when just before Freemasonry arrived in France from England and Scotland, what was France? France is one in the early 70s. France is one of the most populous country in the world. It's also an absolute monarchy. It's already almost a centralized state, where everything goes to Paris and from Paris. And France is going through many religious controversies between Catholic and Protestant, but also inside French Catholicism, where people fight. Already French is a colonial power. So it's a very important country in Europe. It's maybe the 70s is maybe known as the golden century for France. So in 1688, there was a lodge that was created in Saint-Germain, which is a city close to Paris. And we say that it was created from a Scottish regiment in exile. We have no proof, we have no paper to be sure on the historically that it was created, but it's something that stole from generation to generation. Also, there is not fact, but something that is known without any proof, is that in 1721, a lodge was created in Dunkirk, in the north of France, just in front on the French side of the channel. What we know for sure is that in 1725, there is a first lodge in Paris, and this lodge was created by Irish and also Scottish Stuartists in exile in France. So we have a lot of documentation about this one. And also in 1732, a lodge in Bordeaux was created by three Irish merchants who were traveling from Ireland to Bordeaux, which is a city you will see right now. It's a city in the south of France. So here is Dunkirk, maybe an English lodge. Saint-Germain, maybe a Scottish lodge. Surely a Scottish lodge here in Paris. One here in Bordeaux. And also, who were the first French aristocrats? It was not like in England, where many people were, at the beginning, people from trade, or people who were merchants. In France, the first French Freemasons were mainly aristocrats, some priests, many people from the high hierarchy of the military. And at the beginning, and only the beginning, many refugees from England, Ireland, or Scotland. So in 1728, some Parisian Freemasons choose the Duke of Wharton as their first Grand Master. The Duke of Wharton was in visit in France. He met a French Freemason, and they decided to choose him as their first Grand Master. It was only honorific. It was not something, he didn't rule on nothing. And also in 1758, 20 years later, there was a lodge created in Marseille with the warrant from Scotland. We don't have any document, but the story is like this. There is a gentleman coming from Scotland. He created a lodge in Marseille, and he gave the warrant to French Freemasons. And the French Freemason created the lodge. And the lodge of Marseille is very important, but there is not a lot of study about it. It was in the south of France, and it was all around Marseille, all around the Italian Sea. There's a lot of lodge, and it's not a lodge, but this model lodge started in 1751, we're not sure, and it ended at the end of the Napoleonic times. Okay. So the first step is what do the French did when they get the receipt of Freemasonry coming from Ireland or Scotland or England. They get the recipe and they say, as they are French, what can we do with the recipe that we receive? And they change Freemasonry the French way. First thing that they did is they changed the ceremony of reception, and the ceremony of reception in France was a test of courage, of zeal. It means that when back to the through the initiative process, it was not something very nice, like I know in emulation, for instance. It was something very, very quite difficult, quite difficult moment for the initiated. The French Freemasonry was also a safe place for mystical and romantic studies. Things that were not possible in the everyday life and studies were possible inside the lodge. And also, many French Freemasons went on a search for more substantial secrets what was proposed. They think that Freemasonry cannot be only a small ceremony and then going to for, you know, surely there was something else that was behind, something that if you don't find it, maybe you can create the secrets. And from this started an epidemic of mysterious degrees coming from, of course, mysterious origins. There is several influences on the French Masonic ritual. The first one is a book called Thetos. This book is the story of a young prince of Egypt who has to go under an initiatic process to become the king of Egypt. Of course, all the ceremony that was written inside this book, the French Freemason took all the elements inside the book and put inside their own ritual. Which means that you have a ritual in France where during the process of initiation, you have a lot of things to go through to prove that you're a good person to be a Freemason. One also very important influence was the Écossais, which is Scottish or Scottish. As many followers of Jesus were in exile in France, we can find them in the first lodge in Paris, to which extent they used the French lodge to push a political agenda of a Catholic king in exile in France. Anyway, in the early years of Freemasonry in France, the word Écossais is a term used to qualify all superior degrees. Everything above the degree of Master Mason is an Écossais degré, a Scottish degree. So Scottish in France for a long time. Those degrees travel, of course, around France. It means that in every city, people were writing their own ritual. They were exchanging ritual. They were trying to do the best one, or they were selling the degrees. They were rewriting the degrees and so on. So it traveled all around France to a point where a compilation of 20 degrees arrived in Bordeaux. From the city of Bordeaux, the port of Bordeaux, it went to the French West Indies, and eventually it was compiled and written by what is known today as the Supreme Council of the Ancient and Accepted Scottish Rite in Charleston. Another big influence in France is what we call the Rectified. The Rectified is a base of French ritual with the addition of Templar degrees coming from the German states. It's a mix of Templar degrees and Masonic degrees. And the Rectified is still today something very important in France. Another influence, very important in France, was the place of women in Freemasonry. We know now, because it was forgotten for many years, that from 1740, Freemasonry for women is not a joke. It's not an accident. It's not like Elizabeth St. Leger accident. It's something that was a real system. Is what's called the adoption, and it was the part of the French Masonic history. It was so popular to have a lodge for women that in 1774 there was a rule from the Grand Lodge to ask all feminine lodges to be linked to a masculine lodge. Of course, this was done to also get the money from the feminine lodge, but it was also done to have a kind of harmony between all the masculine and feminine lodge. It was really something very important. Why it was so important in France? I think for one main reason. In France, most of the Freemasons were people from the aristocracy. So their wife, their sister, their daughter were people who went to school, who wanted to have the benefits of Freemasonry. and it creates on this was started in 1740, and the end of this system of this system was in the 1950 when the feminine garden was created in France. At the end of the first century of Freemasonry in France, we have this. It's very surprising that in almost every small city, the large city like Paris, Lyon, Toulouse, Marseille, and Bordeaux, you can find something like 10 or 20 Masonic lodges. In every small city in France, along all the corridors for the merchant, you can find Masonic lodge. In 1779, I'm not sure, it seems that you must be something to prove, but I'm almost sure that most of the Freemasons in the world were French. Why? Because in 1779, the USA was a very young country with only 13 ex-colonies, small cities. The population of the UK was half the population of France, and you can see on this map how important was the Freemasonry in France. So maybe this was the moment where there were more French Freemasons than other Freemasons in the world, but it won't last a long time. So the second step of the French Freemasonry, of course, is the period of the Revolution, and today we are. It's the 14th of July, is the time we celebrate the first French Republic, but also the Napoleonic era, and the period when the Freemasonry become an instrument for the struggle for the establishment of the French Republic. The French Freemasons were never an avant-garde, they never tried to be before the French societies. They are always legalists. When it was the monarchy, they were the side of the monarchy. When it was Napoleon, they were the side of Napoleon. And when the Republic took place in France, they were on the side of the Republic. So French Freemasons, all of them, are very legalists. They are not trying to work a revolution or anything. They follow the rest of the French population. But at the end of the 19th century, many liberals, many early socialists become Freemason in France. Why? Because the Masonic lodges were the only places where it was possible to gather, the only place where you can express your idea. Everything that you express will stay inside the lodge. So it was a place for security of your opinions. So because before the Second Republic in France, there was no unions, there was no political parties, there were no place, even newspaper, where you can express your opinions. So a lot of young people get inside the lodge and use it as a political party, undercover, if you want. And so, what happens is that those young liberal people, they become the majority at the GODF, and they decided to dust off the old institution. So they removed some obligation as a belief in God and afterlife, and also the mandatory presence of a Bible inside the lodge. So this is the moment, the period where when the French Freemasonry was really apart from the rest of the Freemasonry around the world. And so from this moment, the GODF Brethren become really on the side, really dedicated to the establishment and the protection of the French Republic. This leads the GODF to be, of course, as a frontal opponent of the Church of Rome, who was against the Republic and in favor of the monarchy. But as French people liked the controversy, inside GODF there were several streams, And one of them thought that the Judaism was not liberal enough. And so they created the GLDF with the help of the Supreme Council of France. From the Supreme Council of more liberal GLDF. Also, there were a few reasons for that. It was possible to have lodged without the movement. And they created something else, which is the Droit Humain. The Droit Humain exists today, and it's a very successful international Masonic order. And finally, there is a third stream, a third group, who decided that the GLDF was not traditional enough. And so they created, with the help of the UGLA, they created the GLNF, from which I am a member. Maybe you saw that during the revolution, all Masonic lodges were closed in France. Many French Freemasons died, and the Freemasons stopped in France for something like 3 years during the revolution. And then the lodges were open again during the period of Napoleon. This was the first time that Freemasonry was banned in France. The second one was in 1940. In 1914, when the Germans arrived in Paris, all the lodges decided to close their door before the police and the German authority arrived in Paris. But they didn't get time to hide all the books, all the rolls, all the list of Freemasons. So here is on the right side of PowerPoint the decree that said that the government and all the grand lodges in France are supposed to be closed, and all their goods, all their lodges are now a building of the French state. And one more thing that did the new government, they decided that in all newspapers every day, they will print a part of the list of the Freemasons to try to shame them. They were expecting that people will be against the Freemasons, and they will publish a list that people will be against the Freemasons. In fact, it was not successful because the list of the Freemasons in the newspaper were people who are like you and me, people who do their everyday work, and it was not impressive at all. Also, in France, if you were during the war, if you were a Freemason, you don't have a right to be also a member of the French administration, which means if you were in the military, in the police, or any job, a teacher or whatever, it was not possible for you. You have to resign. The only way to get back to your work was to sign a document saying, I apologize to have been a Freemason for 10 years. I won't do it again. So it was. But the French Freemason has to suffer at the beginning of the war was not. It was not very nice. But it was not what the Jews or the population has suffered in France during the war. So 1940, for my opinion, is the period where is the end. Of a long period during which the GODF and the French Freemasonry has a real political influence in the everyday life of France. After this, after the war, everything will be changed, and nobody will think that the Freemasonry has a strong influence in the everyday life of the Republic. So this is the third step. So, after 1945, French Freemasonry tried to rebuild itself. They started with around 5,000 active Freemasons, a group of Freemasons for all France. But of course, they didn't unite. They didn't the stream of French famous only keep on working on their side. It was slowly built in the 40s, in the 50s, because people had a more important problem than Freemasonry in the years or the decades of rebuilding. But then the 60s, French Freemasonry crossed a spectacular progression. And this spectacular progression that started in the 70s keep on until today. I think that we have something like for all Masonic organization, we still have 5% progression every year. So today in France, we have, if we take all recognized and unrecognized Freemasons, of course, we have something like 170,000 Freemasons in 5 big organizations and 6,000 lodges. You must know that about 1/6 of Freemason in France are women. And next, let's see the real business. My opinion is that if you're a future Freemason, if you're an apprentice in France, you have the choice. If you don't believe in eagles or any spirituality, you can go to the GODF. If you just have something like a spirituality, you can go to the GLNF. Go to GLNF. If you think that man and woman must work together, you can go to the Drama. And if you're a woman and you want to work with women only, you can go to the Feminine Grand Lodge of France. So you have a choice. You have a choice, and when you are not in the men organization, you're in an organization where there is enough people to have a good work together. It's not a group, it's a large organization. And of course, France, we don't have the problem that they have in the US. We don't have what they call clandestine group or money scam. In these 5 big organizations in France, they are very well known. They have buildings, they are known by your authority. I mean, you can go there, they are not there to take your money. Also, when you're a Freemason, then you will have a diverse menu. You won't have to have the same meal every day. In every group, in every almost every organization in France, you have the choice between 5 or 6 rituals, and they are very different. They are really different. I mean, when you see the difference between the ritual in England between one city or another one, there is difference. They are really on the edge. Here you have a real big difference between the type of ritual that you can experience in France. So maybe after 10 years of Freemasonry, you can be tired to do emulation. But then the next years, you can start in another lodge and try another pass, another Masonic pass. And also, of course, all these type of ritual are for Blue Lodges, excuse me, and you will have also their appendant or high degrees read. Other reason why the Masonic life is very lively in France, for example, we have a Masonic book fair in Paris and in all big cities in France every year. And this brings every year thousands of visitors, and it works since 17 years. And this is open to all type of Freemason. If you're in a mixed lodge, you can go to this Masonic fair. If you're from the GLNF, if you're the GODF, and all these organizations got a table where they can exchange. And also all the people who are selling their own books, people who are printing newspaper, Masonic newspaper, and so on. So I think this helped a lot of Freemasons to keep everything lively, but also for future Freemasons to see how diverse is the French Freemasonry and to find the organization that fits what it needs to start. Also, we have a lot of books, magazines. We have, for example, we have a magazine here in France that you can find almost everywhere. It's a monthly Masonic magazine that you can buy when you arrive at Charles de Gaulle Airport in Paris, if you want. There is many events, academic events, where people from various Masonic organizations can exchange together. I think that some of you today know, for example, the events that that we have in France every 2 years at the National Library. And also something that maybe a lot of French people won't agree with me, but I think that in France, the French media got a positive image of Freemasonry. It's very, it's not very nice for newspapers to be against Freemasonry. It's something like an opinion, and you have to respect people who are in Freemasonry. Also, for the French people, people who are against Freemasonry, Nazi, or people from so to be against Freemasonry is always something that is looked upon. Okay, so I finished this presentation. I just want 1 or 2 minutes to show you some object, something that we think we see in France and that is quite unknown in Scotland. For example, this is the Room of Reflection. It's the place where we send the future before. My Room of Reflection was almost like this one. It was just lighted by all. There was something that's missing on this one. It was a scroll. On the wall of this small you have no explanation. You will learn later the meaning of and sometimes most of the transcripts are not from the one you're used to. Sorry. If you go to a small city in France, small city, this is the way the Masonic temple looks like. What I think you're not used to is that there is no altar in the middle. The altar is here. It's mandatory to have the moon on this side and the sun on this one. Also, in 99% of the Masonic temple, you will have a rope like this around the lodge room. And also, the worshipful master of the third degrees of the star like this. And the first and second warden are always in the west. There is no one in the south. Everybody, the first and the second are on the west side. And for the end, when you visit a lodge in France, you will see that many the type of apron that people will wear are very different, just as in Scotland, but not for the same reason. Here in France, the color of your apron is just meaning it means the type of ritual that you use. So this one is for the French French ritual, and the two letters M and B are of course known by people who went through the degrees. This one with the obviously this color in English, the violet, violet, this scarlet or violet, how do you say this color? This means that the lodge is doing Memphis Mizraim for the blues. This is for the Scottish ancient and accepted, the ancient accepted Scottish rite for the blue lodge, the one, and the blue on the right is for the rectified ritual. Also for the rectified ritual, it's beautiful because people must wear a tricorn, this one in the middle, and they have to, it's mandatory to have a sword on your side. You have to buy your own. For the women, the feminine women, of course, they wear apron like their men counterpart, but also they have to wear this black dress, which is very strange. It looks like you're inside a monastery. You see them going inside and outside the temple. Okay, so I have finished my presentation. I hope I won't too long. I feel it's just okay. Okay.
Brother Frederick, merci. And that's about the extent of my French. And can I just applaud you for presenting to us in English this evening? I think, Frederick, on behalf of everyone here, particularly the Scots, I think this evening on Bastille Day, you've certainly enhanced the Old Alliance, and we have certainly strengthened that tonight. We do have some questions, Bren, and I'll just shut this door so you don't hear my dogs screaming and barking.
Yes.
In the chat room for you, Frederick. So, the first question, Frederick, what is REAA?
It's ancient, right? And when it was created in the USA, in Charleston, they decided that they promised, it was something like a rule, that they will never create a Blue Lodge. So you can find a very interesting book by Albert Pike, where he shared a ritual for the three first degrees. And I read this, I think the name of this book is The Porche or something like this. And when you read the ritual inside, it's clearly a French ritual. Yeah. So the ancient accepted Scottish rite for the Blue Lodge was the ritual were created by the Supreme Council in France. Okay, and everywhere around the world.
The next question, was General de Gaulle a Freemason?
No, he was not, but he was very nice with Freemason, because even before the France was, when the first part of France at the time where the North Africa was free from the German, the first decree that he, one of the first decree was to say that all the laws against Freemasonry were illegal. And that all of the information can take.
Okay, thank you.
So, he's just a character. He was really, very, very Catholic, but he against the reasons.
Okay, thank you. One from Ian McIntosh, he's a resident expert on the Jacobites, and he's asking, is it possible to name the exiled Scottish regiment that you mentioned in 1688? Frederick, do you know the name of the Scottish regiment from 1688?
I have. I know the name, but I don't remember the name, sorry.
No worries.
But it's really easy to find, really easy to find.
Well, I'll endeavour, so that will be my challenge for this evening, Ian, to try and find it for you. And that's a similar question. a question, Frederick, from were there any other famous politicians in the craft?
I think this is one of the reasons why I say that the French Freemasonry don't have any more influence on the political life in France. Yes, we have some people from the government since the end of World War II. We have some of them. But I think none of them you that we'll know outside of France.
Okay. Thanks.
We don't have people like Charles de Gaulle or people like this, or François Mitterrand and the other president that we had in France since World War II.
Okay. Brother Mike Hearn, one of the past masters from one of our sister research lodges, Lodge Felix, has put up a couple of links to Lane's Masonic Records that mentions the lodges in Bordeaux, and I will post those later on this evening on the Facebook page. And there's Derek Elder writing out, right, écossais ancient et accepté. Well, it's my best five French accent you're going to get, Ryan. Ian McIntosh again, you did not mention the part played by Chevalier Andrew Ramsay with his oration. Did he play a big part in the establishment of Freemasonry in France?
Yes. I think this the discourse of Ramsay is always the point where you start when you want to explain all the ideas in France. Because in this discourse, he said that Freemasonry is not only the three degrees, is something more, something else, something more universal. And this will open the gate to many, many ritual and high degrees.
Okay, thank you. Again, a question that I think you covered. Are the male and female lodges separate?
I'm not sure. I believe it's almost like the system that they got in the USA. You know, they have a system called the Eastern Star, where the feminine lodge is autonomous. But for certain ceremony, they have the help of a brother. So I think at the beginning, it was something like this. The women were doing their ceremony on their side, men on their side, and they were going for the meal together or for a ball together. So,
okay, that makes sense. And again, in Scotland, Frederick, for your information, we do have the Eastern Star, and maybe not as strong as it was back in the day, but we certainly are very aware of it. A question around the Second World War, Frederick. Where French Freemasons transported to Germany in World War II, and I'm assuming he means to the camps such as Auschwitz and Bergen-Belsen, etc.
No, it's a very sensitive question, but what I was trying to say in my presentation is to be a Freemason was not something that qualified you to be wake up in the morning by the SS and bring to a train. So there were people who really suffered during the war. I think if you were a partisan, a resistant, and also a Freemason, it was not good. But if you were a former Freemason, not doing any noise, I think it was okay. No, it's not like being from one confession and they get everyone from this confession. And we even have a case at the end of World War II when they don't have enough people to manage the government, and they try to have exemption for some old Freemasons because they need people to work the government. So I think it's something we need to read. And there is a very nice, very interesting paper from Alain Bernheim about it. I think we need to read and reread it again, because the way we think about the Freemasons during World War II was not that important, that what we say for the forgiveness and so on.
Okay, thank you, Frederick. Yes, I think we all feel the sensitivities around that period in Europe's history. Brother Alan Turton, you've got your hand up and I've unmuted you, so I'm assuming you want to say something, sir.
Thank you very much. That's very kind of you. Frederick, it's the second time I've listened to this talk. Absolutely superb. And thinking about the liberality of French Freemasonry, one of the things that expresses it for me are your conferences. I've attended both the Paris Conference and the ICON Conference. Could you tell the brethren a little bit about that? Because it really is a very exciting thing to do.
And we have many events like this one. We have the ICOM in Toulon. We have the ICOM in Bordeaux. We have the thing that is done by French and American Freemason every 2 or 3 years in Paris. And we have a lot of events like this. And it's very interesting to see people who are Mason or non-Mason studying Freemasonry. Because it's very strange. We Freemasons, most of the time, we know that something are not historical, but we don't want to see it. And sometimes it's nice to have someone from outside of Freemasonry. I remember when the book of, I think it's Stevenson, about Scotland was published 10 years ago, it changed everything that we believed about Freemasonry at the beginning. Don't you agree, Alan?
I totally agree. The whole thing is so liberal because you've got Freemasons from every walk of Freemasonry attending, huge book sales happening at the conferences, and so many people talking about so many varieties of Freemasonry. It's a very, very exciting environment to be in, and certainly expresses the liberality of the French approach to Freemasonry. We used to have a little bit of this at the International History Conferences on Freemasonry in Edinburgh.
Yes, yes.
And one of the things that Gordon is flagshipping that we're hoping to get off the floor is to restart these conferences, possibly in Fife or Edinburgh. But we're hoping within the near future to get a conference happening in Scotland. I don't know why. England has always backed off from having a conference. We've only had one supported by the United Grand Lodge of England, and that was held in Sheffield. The conference was called the Band of Brothers through Sheffield University. Mm-hmm. So I would urge you, brethren, you know, if you get the opportunity to go, these conferences are very, very Masonically exciting places to be, very lively.
Thank you, Alan. Thank you very much for that.
Thank you very much. Very good talk. Brilliant.
Thank you.
Frederick, without giving any secrets away, does the installation of a master vary significantly from what happens in UGLE and Grand Lodge of Scotland?
In fact, in France, the installation ceremony was unknown. And I think the first ritual we were using it was the Memphis Mithraim ritual. I think we got some version through Yarker in France. And many people were the ceremony didn't exist. I remember I was working at the worshipful master asking us, please, can you do the ceremony for me? This was very funny. Now, it's common to see in France people with the symbol on their apron, meaning that they were installed as a master of the lodge. But it was something that it was not in France. Back in the days, there was no installation of the worshipful master. No ceremony, I mean.
Okay.
And now it's very popular.
Okay, thank you, Frederick, for that. Well, Brian, as it is Bastille Day, and Frederick has potentially got fireworks if the COVID-19 is allowing them to happen, and possibly military parades happening on the TV this evening in France, I would just like to say a huge thank you on behalf of the Lodge Hope of Karachi and all our visitors here this evening for coming along and giving us an insight into the history of Freemasonry in France. And I think, as the majority of us on this evening's call are from Scotland, I think there is that old alliance, that connection between the two nations that I think is very important to many. So on behalf of us all, Frederick, thank you very much. Bryan, it's my intention to pause the recording now this evening because I think that was part of the challenges from last week. And then I will unmute everyone to say your thank yous and your good nights.